Good afternoon. Boa tarde. Excuse me, I'm going to take off my mask for a while. Before we start, some announcements. This event has the support of the NSF translation team, Ana Casales and Márcio Cibianto, simultaneous interpreting between Portuguese and English. Those of you attending this event online can listen to the seminar in a specific language. Please select the preferred language now from the global icon that appears at the bottom of your screen. Nosso evento hoje conta com o apoio da equipe de tradução NSF, Ana Casales e Márcio Cipanto, fazendo a interpretação simultânea entre português e inglês. Para aqueles que participam desse evento online, você pode ouvir esse seminário em um idioma específico. Selecione agora o idioma da sua preferência no ícone do globo que aparece na parte inferior da sua tela. Remember that this event is being recorded. The recording will be available on our website, clarec.org. In addition, during the event, you who follow us online will be able to submit your questions through the Q&A tool located also in the bottom of the screen. We also invite you to use the chat tool to tell us where in the world you are watching this event from and communicate your thoughts and feelings during this seminar. So I'm Alexandre Trindade, PhD student at the Faculty of Education here in Cambridge and a member of the Cambridge Latin America Research in Education Collective, CLAREC, who welcomes you today for this very special event. On behalf of the collective, we thank you for being here with us today, in person or virtually. Today, Paula Castro, who is connected online from Brazil, as well as Rocio Fernandes and myself from the auditorium have the honor of hosting this event. So CLAREC is a collective formed by academic students from the Faculty of Education at the University of Cambridge. It aims to constitute a space for Latin American perspectives that bring together researchers working in Latin America context and those interested in hearing more about them. Our key objective is to make the region's knowledge production visible and share current debates linked to education research towards the diversification and decolonization of academia. Based on these principles, and in order to democratize the privileged space we occupy in this institution, we intend to build a collective and collaborative environment to promote the meeting of perspective formed inside and outside the university. We advocate that the university should be open and committed to traditional perspectives and knowledge that are not developed within its own spaces and voices. We believe that only by valuing and integrating other knowledges, we'll be able to transform the university into a genuine environment that which arise relevant contributions to society, especially concern social sectors whose knowledge, histories, and voices have been marginalized or even erased. This year marks the centenary of birth of one of the greatest thinkers in education. Today we begin a two-week journey to celebrate Paulo Freire and his legacy. The program was organized by CLAREC with the collaboration of the academic community of the Faculty of Education, along with external partners, institutions, collectives, and social movements. Paulo Freire's work has reached a global dimension. In particular, his masterpiece, Pedagogy of the Oppressed, is considered one of the foundation tests of critical pedagogy. One that advocates a lot many things, but a pedagogy with a new relationship between teachers, students, and society. Freire's work has contributed to reflection in social sciences, and debates involve economics, politics, culture, and critical social issues such as gender, race, and environment justice. This includes debates upon the role of education, and it relates to issues such as power, politics, colonialism, justice, and social action, and how this topic is connected to education as a means of social transformation. We hope these activities will promote a democratic and vibrant space in which both perspectives in support or question Freire's arguments are welcome, so we can explore the legacies of his work together. Today, we are also inaugurating and exhibiting a bust of Paulo Freire here at the Faculty of Education that we hope will symbolize the perpetuity of his legacy, in particular of unending possibilities of dialogue with the world. We are very honored and moved by the symbolic act that has very special meaning for the Latin American academic community, especially in such challenging times in the region. This sculpture is part of the unique collection created by Murilo Satoledo at the request of the Brazilian Landless Works Movement, MST, to celebrate Paulo Freire's centennial. Freire's ideas are at the core of the education model developed by this social movement in Brazil. According to the MST, memories of struggle need to be cultivated collectively, and its symbology need to be part of the pedagogical process that cultivates stories, projected dreams of transforming reality. As such, this artistic piece endeavors to strengthen Freire's legacy in education, in social change, through the physical presence in education space, including learning communities, schools, and settlements, and stimulate debates around Freire's educational thinking. This sculpture was donated to the Faculty of Education by the Cambridge University Brazilian Society, CUBS, as part of Freire's centenary anniversary celebration. We could not start this event without expressing our deep gratitude to the Faculty of Education community, who generously welcomed the proposal of this celebration and has spared no effort to support us in implementing our ideas. In particular, we thank Professor Susan Robertson, head of the faculty, Hira Gandolf, Ricardo Sabatis, David Carter, Raquel Santiago, Patrick Boyd, Tom Kirk, John Chiffins, Clary McKenzie, Andrew Barkett, and the Education Library team. We are also immensely grateful to the artist Ivan Geronimo, who allowed us to use his art to make this celebration even more meaningful and beautiful. We could also like to thank each of the groups who joined in organizing this celebration, along with their members. The Cambridge Education Dialogue Research, the Cambridge University Brazilian Society, the Decolonized Language Education Collective, the Emancipa University, the Florestan Fernandes National School, the Faculty of Education Research Student Association, the Federal University of São Paulo, the Innovation Policy Analysis Group from Unicamp, the Institute Bell Hooks Paulo Freire, the Integrated Center of Youth and Adult Education, the Knowledge Power Politics Research Cluster, the Leadership and Learning Network, the Landless Rural Works Movement, the Psychology, Education and Learning Studies Research Group, the Research for Equitable Access and Learning Center, Rio Center, and the University of East Anglia. To welcome everyone to this open event, I now turn the floor to the supporters who made this celebration possible. First, I invite Professor Susan Robertson, head of the Faculty of Education at Cambridge.
First of all, let me just say what a wonderful privilege it is to stand not just before you today, And to congratulate the group who were inspired to honor the legacy of Paulo Freire. Faculty of Education is a place that encourages, it seems to me, the celebration of those who've inspired us. And we should constantly, it seems to me, encounter their works and those who walk in their footsteps, as we'll see today. As the head of the faculty, it gives me a great sense of pleasure to actually also recognize the ways in which your group, Alex, Rocio, Jaira, Sebastian, have organized the kind of coalition of energies, insightfulness, individuals that have come together to not just put this evening's occasion on, but to actually roll out a series of events that actually have us encounter Paulo Freire's work. My first encounter, and this tells you how old I am, was in the 1970s in the Pedagogy of the Oppressed. And I remember writing a master's paper in Perth at the University of Western Australia on that work. It was clearly in conversation with other great minds that were very influential at the time, Julius Nyerere and others. I then went to take on a PhD, and Carlos, I wonder if you were the place up in Edmonton that invited Freire, but he came to Alberta. I remember going to listen to him, and I suspect he came to the University of Calgary, maybe up to Edmonton, and I think you were probably there at that moment. But Freire never goes away, and I'm just going to quote Carlos's words here. We can stay with Freire or against, but not without. And I just want to remind us, as we stand on the eve of major debates, we hope there'll be debates around climate change, COP26. In a week or so's time, UNESCO will launch its major report on from the Commission on the Futures of Education. And in that report, which I have seen an advanced copy, the urgency of the need for the kinds of intellectual projects and resources that Freire kind of stood for, it seems to me right at this moment, where we stand, not just in this space, but in this moment of history, are the kinds of intellectual resources that we badly need in the academy. The academy is facing all kinds of threats to its freedoms, freedoms that we never thought we would be having to defend. The academy is often a space where, in fact, there's been a diminution of tolerance, and yet everything that Freire talked about, the idea of living, loving, trying to know, being tolerant, being a curious person, as he describes himself in this video, all of those are the resources that will enable us to both listen to each other and learn to try and live not only well with each other, but well with our planet. So I can't think of a better moment, occasion, both to welcome Ana Maria Sayol, Carlos, tonight, to be with us tonight, to actually share your footsteps, your engagements, your encounters with a person that, while he's often described as a rock star, is actually a star whose rock, if we grasp hold of the metaphor of this rock, might ground us as we move into the future, into a future that somehow all of you in this academy and all of the social movements that have come together to create and make this event and these days that follow possible, that somehow we can find degrees of solidity, a sense of purpose, a way of navigating forward in this world. So it's a big challenge, but thank you so much to everyone that's here tonight. Thank you to all of you that have come in virtually. It's incredibly important to have this kind of occasion. So I'm going to pass the mic back to you. Thank you, Alex.
Thank you so much for always offering highly inspired words, Suzanne. It has been like a very huge difference for us as students to have this environment and stimulate us to find the way and the field of possibilities in this faculty. Thank you so much. I would like just to say thank you very much for class, for the Center of Latin America Studies here in Cambridge, who support us. Today we have the director of class, Gabriela Ramos. Thank you so much for being with us today. And also in class, Gabriela, I would like to extend the gratitude because class has been a very important partner with the collective since the beginning. So since they create the collective. We also would like to thank you, Julie Coimbra, Felipe Hernandez, and Pedro Loureiro, who always have been support us. And to close this introductory part of the event, we would like to welcome Professor Moacir Gadotti, Honorary President of the Paulo Freire Institute, who recorded a special video from Brazil to share with us.
Olá. Fico muito feliz e agradecido pelo convite para participar dessa celebração do centenário de Paulo Freire na Universidade de Cambridge, organizada pelo Coletivo Latino-Americano de Pesquisa em Educação. Via programação, uma programação robusta, elaborada com muito cuidado, com muito rigor científico, como gostaria exatamente Paulo Freire, como faria Paulo Freire também neste momento. O Instituto Paulo Freire se sente muito honrado de poder participar dessa celebração e dessa... Fico muito feliz. Olá. Fico muito feliz e agradecido pelo convite para participar dessa celebração do centenário de Paulo Freire na Universidade de Cambridge, organizada pelo Coletivo Latino-Americano de Pesquisa em Educação. Via programação, uma programação robusta, elaborada com muito cuidado, com muito rigor científico, como gostaria exatamente Paulo Freire, como faria Paulo Freire também neste momento. O Instituto Paulo Freire se sente muito honrado de poder participar dessa celebração e dessa iniciativa muito particular. Eu estou aqui na biblioteca de Paulo Freire, ao lado da mesa dele de trabalho, e aqui também recebemos o Alexandre da Trindade para organizar essa parceria com a Universidade de Cambridge, ocasião em que nós também podemos oferecer um exemplar dos manuscritos da Pedagogia do Oprimido de Paulo Freire para a biblioteca da Faculdade de Educação da Universidade de Cambridge. Para nós, esse espaço é muito particular, evidentemente muito simbólico, né? Porque aqui também esteve Paulo Freire muito tempo, alguns anos, né, no final da vida dele, organizando conosco a programação do Instituto Paulo Freire, que hoje está presente em mais de 20 países. Quero saudar de modo muito particular a Susan Robertson, diretora da Faculdade de Educação, e a Gabriela Ramos, diretora do... Claro, saudar de modo também muito especial Ana Maria Saul e Carlos Alberto Torres, queridos amigos, saudar os estudantes, professores que, neste momento, compartilham conosco dessas celebrações. Nos últimos meses, nós vimos muitas celebrações em diferentes partes do mundo. Para nós, essas celebrações têm um caráter, eu diria, estruturante, no sentido de que são celebrações que têm um caráter prospectivo, um caráter como se fosse um espaço-tempo de organização, de articulação, um processo formativo como a celebração que estamos iniciando hoje. Um processo de transformação também. Esse é o momento de celebrações de Paulo Freire, em que se mostra que ele cruzou as fronteiras das disciplinas, das ciências, para além da América Latina, né? E criando raízes nos mais diferentes variados solos. Isso mostra não só a atualidade do pensamento, do legado de Paulo Freire, mas também a necessidade que temos desse pensamento no momento que vivemos de ataques à democracia e de avanço do neoconservadorismo no mundo. Aceitemos ou não as contribuições de Paulo Freire, ele é um marco decisivo na história do pensamento pedagógico mundial. Paulo Freire nos dizia com muita frequência que o sonho dele era o sonho da liberdade, mas não de qualquer liberdade. A liberdade que me ajuda a brigar pela justiça. Por isso que, quando ele falava de educação, não defendia qualquer educação, mas aquela educação que emancipava. Portanto, uma educação popular, como ele dizia, uma educação em direitos humanos, uma educação cidadã. Por isso, creio que nós temos, sim, muitas razões para celebrar Paulo Freire nesse seu centenário, porque ele nos ajuda a reinventar a educação. Por que reinventar a educação? Como ele nos dizia. Porque esse não é o único mundo possível, nem é um mundo imutável, como também a educação que temos não é a única educação possível e nem é imutável. De nada adianta, como paradigma hegemônico estabelece, cria no mundo esse paradigma que pretende instrumentalizar as pessoas para ser melhor do que as outras. Creio que não se trata de chegar primeiro, trata-se de todos chegarem juntos. Por isso precisamos de uma educação como um bem comum, orientado por outro paradigma, baseado no conviver, não no vencer. A vida não se resume em vencer ou não vencer. Precisamos de outra educação. Um bom encontro a todas e a todos. Obrigado.
Olá, boa tarde. Meu nome é Paula Teixeira de Castro. Eu sou doutoranda da Faculdade de Educação de Cambridge. Estou, no momento, em São Paulo, fazendo a coleta de dados da minha pesquisa. E vou estar aqui hoje à tarde para fazer um welcome muito especial à tarde e à noite aí para vocês em Cambridge. Né? Então, mais uma vez, boa tarde, boa noite a todas e a todos. Fazer parte desse evento é uma ação de conscientização. É ativar a consciência de que somos seres históricos e que, pela ação intencional, escrevemos a nossa história. Foi certamente uma importante aprendizagem construída ao longo desses últimos meses, nos quais experimentamos a preparação colaborativa das iniciativas que vamos viver nesses próximos 12 dias. Teremos oportunidades únicas de pensar e ressignificar juntos o legado de Paulo Freire a partir de perspectivas múltiplas, organizadas com muito afinco pelo CLAREC, o Coletivo de Pesquisadores Latino-Americanos em Cambridge, com um apoio irrestrito da Faculdade de Educação da Universidade de Cambridge. Para iniciarmos esse diálogo, marco relevante na história de nosso contexto acadêmico em Cambridge, temos a honra e o privilégio de recebermos a professora doutora Ana Maria Saul, da Pontifícia Universidade Católica de São Paulo, no Brasil, exatamente onde lecionou com e ao lado de Paulo Freire nos seus últimos 17 anos de vida. Hoje, o mundo tem amplo acesso à figura pública do Paulo Freire, ao seu pensamento registrado nos mais diversos formatos, nos seus livros, em estudos, pesquisas, documentários, em análises acadêmicas profundas. Nosso privilégio, neste momento histórico da celebração do centenário de Freire aqui na Faculdade de Educação, é conversarmos com alguém que nos traz um outro Freire, alguém que flagrou a prática pedagógica do professor Paulo Freire, professor em ação na sala de aula da PUC, cuja porta esteve sempre aberta para os que dela quisessem participar, praticando o ato dialógico, o qual ele próprio concebeu. Com a voz da professora Ana Saul é de extrema relevância para ampliarmos nossa experiência com o pensamento freiriano, não somente pelo testemunho do seu convívio sistemático com Paulo Freire, professor e gestor público da cidade de São Paulo, gestão essa da qual Ana foi diretora de orientação técnica, responsável pelo movimento de reorientação curricular e pela formação permanente dos professores. Mas a relevância de sua voz, sobretudo, é por sua dedicação de mais de 3 décadas na formação de gerações de educadores pesquisadores que se debruçam sobre o pensamento de Freire e também por sua intensa produção intelectual na articulação nacional e internacional do legado teórico-prático de Paulo Freire. Tudo isso a partir do seu irretocável trabalho como coordenadora da Cátedra Paulo Freire na PUC de São Paulo desde 1999. Professora Ana Maria Saul é mestre e doutora em educação pela Pontifícia Universidade Católica de São Paulo, professora titular da PUC, atuando nos programas de pós-graduação em educação, currículo em educação e no mestrado profissional Formação de Formadores, coordena a Cátedra Paulo Freire desta instituição, onde desenvolve ensino e pesquisa sobre o pensamento freiriano, com destaque para os temas políticas públicas, currículo e formação de educadores. É pesquisadora nível 1 do CNPq e líder do grupo de pesquisa O Pensamento de Paulo Freire na Educação Brasileira. Saul é membro do corpo editorial da revista científica E Currículum, do Conselho Editorial da Revista Brasileira de Estudos Pedagógicos e da Revista em Aberto do INEP. Coordena a Rede Freiriana de Pesquisadores, é membro do Grupo de Trabalho de Currículo da Associação Nacional de Pós-Graduação em Pesquisa em Educação, AMPED, e integra o quadro de sócios da Associação Brasileira de Currículo. Professora Ana, é um prazer e a palavra é toda sua.
Muito obrigada, Paula. Boa tarde a todas, todos e todes que nos acompanham nessa sessão. Eu agradeço com alegria aos organizadores desse evento pelo convite que me foi feito para participar desse momento muito especial. Eu tive o prazer de compartilhar com Freire durante 17 anos o espaço da sala de aula, e por isso posso testemunhar a coerência entre o seu fazer docente, originado de sua reflexão sobre sua prática como educador, e suas proposições político-pedagógicas. Eu quero iniciar fazendo, como dizia Paulo Freire, um acercamento ao tema dessa exposição, dizendo muito brevemente como foi o meu encontro com o mestre. Eu o conheci, provavelmente, como muitos educadores do mundo, através de seus livros proibidos na década de 60, quando ele estava no exílio. O acesso aos seus escritos só me foi possível em reuniões secretas do movimento universitário. Em 1979, tive a chance de ver Paulo Freire ser recebido no Teatro da Pontifícia Universidade Católica de São Paulo, quando ele retornou do exílio e abrindo os braços para a imensa multidão que o assistia, disse, eu vim, humildemente disse, eu vim reaprender o Brasil. Passei, então, a trabalhar com Paulo Freire na PUC, em 1980, no programa de pós-graduação em Educação Currículo. Eu era responsável por uma das disciplinas obrigatórias do curso, e ele ministrava aulas sobre educação popular. Nós nos vimos formalmente em uma reunião administrativa do programa de pós-graduação, e uma semana depois, quando eu estava sozinha na sala de professores, em um horário de almoço, revendo algumas notas para entrar em sala de aula, fui tomada de surpresa. Paulo Freire entrou na sala, cumprimentou-me e disse, menina, tu sabes fazer aquele plano de curso que temos que entregar à coordenadora? Ele estava com uma ficha na mão. Os temas sobre os quais vou tratar, disse-me ele, estão aqui. Não sei como colocá-los na forma do plano que foi pedido. Tu podes me ajudar? Eu não sabia bem como reagir. Com um misto de respeito e timidez, respondi que eu sabia o que se costumava pedir na PUC como plano de curso e que poderia tentar colocar as decisões dele sobre o curso no formato de plano. Disse ainda que eu lhe mostraria antes para que ele conferisse e fizesse as alterações necessárias. Assumi essa incumbência com a maior responsabilidade. Parece que eu estava adivinhando que esse encontro seria o início de uma relação especial, na qual se desenvolveu uma grande amizade e a possibilidade de um trabalho conjunto, singular, com grande parceria e aprendizado. Depois disso, fizemos muitos contatos. O plano de curso foi um bom pretexto. O programa de pós-graduação onde trabalhávamos passou por uma reformulação, propondo seminários para orientar a pesquisa dos alunos. Esses seminários seriam conduzidos por dois professores em conjunto. Paulo Freire e eu fomos incumbidos de coordenar os seminários nesta nova organização. Passamos a trabalhar juntos às terças-feiras à tarde. Tínhamos um contato semanal em sala de aula e nos encontrávamos também nas reuniões do programa e em momentos de planejamento dos seminários. Para o planejamento dos seminários, Paulo Freire costumava me chamar para um almoço ou um café em sua casa. Depois partíamos, como ele dizia, para o planejamento. E foi na casa dele que eu aprendi a comer e a gostar de comidas nordestinas, que eu nem conhecia, aqui do nosso país. Ele procurava sempre me ouvir e estávamos pensando, então, em relação ao próximo semestre. Daí, discutíamos bastante e chegávamos às propostas. Ele fazia questão de ressaltar que os nossos desejos, os nossos sonhos de professores seriam confrontados com os sonhos dos alunos e, por isso, propunha que a primeira coisa que faríamos em sala de aula seria discutir a nossa proposta com os alunos. Considerávamos, para planejar as aulas, as possibilidades de tratamento da temática, as avaliações semestrais e as expectativas dos alunos. Procurávamos discutir os nossos desejos, os nossos sonhos, em relação às nossas utopias como professores, como docentes do programa com os alunos. Esses diálogos com Paulo Freire foram sempre muito ricos e fraternos. No primeiro dia de aula, ele se preocupava inicialmente em ouvir os alunos para que as necessidades e expectativas deles estivessem contempladas no trabalho a ser desenvolvido. Isso era feito numa sala de aula arrumada em círculo, ambiente propício ao diálogo, onde todos os participantes podiam se ver face a face, e onde Paulo Freire podia tocar alguns dos participantes da roda que estavam à sua direita ou à sua esquerda, colocando delicadamente a mão sobre seus ombros. E fazia isto, em alguns momentos, num gesto muito espontâneo, como que quisesse melhor ser entendido ou ainda para chamar o seu interlocutor à participação. Quem conviveu com Paulo Freire e teve a oportunidade de estar mais perto dele, seguramente vai se lembrar da expressividade dos seus gestos. Ele era um homem que falava com as mãos. Na condução do trabalho de sala de aula, Paulo Freire propunha que, num primeiro momento, ouvíssemos as preocupações de investigação, de pesquisa dos alunos. Mesmo que os projetos dos discentes fossem embrionários, ele fazia questão de estimulá-los a dizer os seus sonhos, ainda que esses não estivessem detalhados ou totalmente claros. A partir do relato dos alunos, passava-se a um segundo momento em que se trabalhava com as diferentes temáticas apresentadas, na busca dos eixos importantes em cada um dos projetos e dos fios comuns entre eles. Deste modo, eram aprofundados os temas fundamentais que contribuíam para os diferentes projetos por meio de diálogo e indicações bibliográficas. Além de selecionar os tópicos básicos que seriam discutidos, Paulo Freire considerava muito importante propor aos alunos que se exercitassem na produção escrita durante o curso e discutissem a sua produção em sala de aula no grupo classe. Ele me dizia: vamos propor aos alunos que, em cada sessão, a cada aula, eles possam reagir, não só no momento, verbalmente, dizendo o que pensam a respeito das temáticas, mas vamos também desafiá-los para escrever pequenos textos, uma página que seja, e na sessão seguinte nós vamos ouvir essas páginas e vamos nos manifestar em relação a elas. De um modo recorrente, na análise dos projetos, surgiam prioritariamente os temas: justiça social, poder, liberdade, democracia, utopia, ética, construção do conhecimento, compromisso social, formação do educador, da educadora, educação como ato político, leitura da realidade, valores do ser humano. Paulo Freire fazia questão de insistir sobre esses temas de modo coloquial, ele nos dizia: vocês que estão comigo há muito tempo, certamente já começam a adivinhar o que eu vou responder, porque faço questão de insistir sobre alguns temas. Esse modo de ser e de fazer de Paulo Freire, centrados em proposições fundamentais de sua obra, como respeito ao educando, dialogicidade, importância de partir do conhecimento do aluno no processo ensino-aprendizagem, a defesa da autoridade do professor e não do autoritarismo, a politicidade da educação, foram por vezes criticados. Não foram raros os momentos que essas questões, essas críticas, foram trazidas para a sala de aula por alunos e mesmo por outros professores que encontravam esses questionamentos em algum texto ou congresso que frequentavam. Paulo Freire não se cansava de retomar as explicações, aprofundando os seus argumentos. Todavia, ele não deixava de se referir a uma justa raiva em relação às críticas que lhe faziam sem fundamentação. Ele insistia muito que a crítica era importante, mas que ela precisava ser fundamentada. A presença de Paulo Freire na sala de aula sempre foi muito querida, marcante, significativa. A sua atuação na aula era discreta. Apesar de ele saber que a sua palavra fazia diferença, com humildade autêntica, raramente era o primeiro a falar. Exercitava, assim, um dos saberes que, em seu último livro publicado enquanto vivia, Pedagogia da Autonomia, apontou como necessários à prática educativa, aspas, saber escutar. Ele ouvia a todos atente e respeitosamente, e quando se posicionava, ouvíamos a sua voz mansa, que revelava, porém, uma postura forte que convidava a pensar. O clima democrático e cordial da sala de aula permitia que os alunos se experimentassem na produção da escrita e, ao mesmo tempo, pudessem dizer de suas dificuldades. Paulo Freire, por vezes, fez exposições muito interessantes a respeito da superação das dificuldades para a produção de um texto. Ele contava como ele escrevia. Dizia que, às vezes, ele se punha diante de uma página e ficava tempo sem que realmente a possibilidade da escrita viesse. Com isso, ele revelava na prática a coragem que o professor precisa ter de se expor diante da classe, demonstrando seus sonhos, a sua ideologia, a sua compreensão da realidade e da produção do conhecimento, mas também as suas dificuldades e os seus sentimentos. No penúltimo semestre em que trabalhamos juntos, ele estava escrevendo o livro Pedagogia da Autonomia, concluído em setembro de 1996. Uma das alunas, ao expor em uma das aulas a sua página, que era uma página da sua dissertação de mestrado, disse a ele: "Olhe, Paulo, às vezes eu tenho uma sensação de que aquilo que escrevi não vale muito a pena e tenho vontade de rasgar tudo e jogar no lixo." Paulo Freire disse a ela em tom incisivo e muito bem-humorado: "Não faça isto, veja bem, eu também estou escrevendo um livro", e era a Pedagogia da Autonomia. "Eu vou dizer para você que ele até pode ser um livro rasgável, não sei ainda. Às vezes eu também sou tomado pelo sentimento de que o que a gente está produzindo nem sempre é totalmente bom, nem sempre a gente está totalmente satisfeito com o que faz." Em quase todas as semanas que se seguiram a esse fato, pedíamos notícias a ele sobre, entre aspas, o livro rasgável. Numa tarde de terça-feira, ele chegou e disse: "Hoje eu quero dar uma notícia a vocês. Já terminei aquele livro rasgável." Ao comentar sobre sua forma de produção, Paulo Freire sugeriu aos alunos alguns procedimentos para enfrentar as dificuldades da escrita. Uma das coisas que ele fazia, que ele dizia dar muito certo, era voltar no dia seguinte ao que se escreveu no dia anterior. Reler o que já se fez, como um aquecimento para rever, reformular ou ir adiante. Mencionava constantemente outra prática dele e que fazia questão de recomendar a todos nós: o uso de bons e diferentes dicionários. Eu tive a oportunidade, muitas vezes, de visitá-lo em sua casa, em seu escritório, onde ele escrevia, e observei que ele mantinha os dicionários muito próximos de sua escrivaninha, bem à mão, atrás dele, para utilizá-los a todo momento. Paulo Freire não se cansava de mencionar a importância do uso de dicionários de língua portuguesa para que a escrita fosse estética. Ele prezava muito a qualidade da linguagem, por isso não se furtava de, no momento oportuno, sempre com muita cortesia, fazer, entre aspas, como ele dizia, certas sugestões de linguagem aos alunos. Dizia fazer isto como necessidade, como método, para garantir a boniteza da linguagem. Nessas situações, ele fazia questão de dizer que a seriedade, a rigorosidade do educador não deve ser separada da alegria, não deve ser separada da estética. Ressaltava ainda que ser político, no sentido de ter um direcionamento claro, um compromisso claro com a transformação, não nos exime da responsabilidade de fazer isso de uma forma estética, de uma forma bonita, alegre e prazerosa. Ele dizia que não é preciso ser sisudo para ser sério. É muito possível e desejável que se faça a educação com bom humor, alegria e amorosidade. Os encontros com Paulo Freire sempre foram reflexivos, interessantes, fraternos e surpreendentes. Era admirável a sua clareza de análise do mundo. Inquieto e instigante, buscava sempre coerência em sua vida e em sua obra, mostrando-se indignado com as injustiças sociais. Revelava sempre, no entanto, coragem, humildade e esperança. Quando Freire já não estava entre nós, em sua homenagem, a PUC de São Paulo criou, no segundo semestre de 1998, a Cátedra Paulo Freire, sob a direção do Programa de Educação Currículo, no qual Freire trabalhou. O sentido que buscamos imprimir à cátedra é a de um espaço-tempo singular de estudo e produção de conhecimento, sendo possível, desse modo, compreender e reinventar o pensamento de Paulo Freire. Nesse locus de estudos e debates, são analisadas as repercussões políticas, teórico-práticas, do pensamento freiriano para a educação no Brasil e no exterior, em uma perspectiva crítica. Dois cursos anuais em nível de pós-graduação são oferecidos no contexto da cátedra, nos quais são trabalhadas as dimensões políticas, teóricas e práticas da pedagogia freiriana para a docência e para a pesquisa. Lembrando que Paulo Freire, com humildade intelectual, afirmou que não queria ser imitado, mas recriado, eu procuro reinventar a prática pedagógica de Freire, preservando, porém, os princípios de sua pedagogia. Nesta comunicação, quero apresentar uma construção teórico-metodológica com a qual venho trabalhando. Trata-se do que denomino trama conceitual freiriana, uma construção inspirada nos escritos de Freire, ao dizer de suas tramas vividas, para nomear os acontecimentos de sua vida. Esses acontecimentos, segundo o autor, são tramas historicamente situadas e sujeitas a múltiplos condicionamentos. E eu tenho trabalhado com a ideia de trama conceitual para articular os conceitos da obra freiriana. O slide que vou compartilhar a seguir traz a representação gráfica de uma trama conceitual freiriana que tem no centro o conceito formação permanente. Vou pedir a Paula aí que me ajude a compartilhar o slide. Pode ser, Paula?
Sim, professora, estou compartilhando. Sim. Acho que já está.
Então, ok. Estamos aí com ele, tela? Sim. Essa é uma representação gráfica. Para chegar a esses conceitos, eu parto de um momento da metodologia de Freire, que é a busca dos interesses, das preocupações dos estudantes. E esse momento se chama investigação temática. Eu busco os temas de interesse sobre os quais vamos construir o currículo daquele semestre. Este slide mostra uma construção de uma trama do primeiro semestre de 2021, deste ano ainda, onde os estudantes desse grupo da cátedra tinham muito interesse, com predominância, no conceito de formação permanente. Suas pesquisas iam girar, sobretudo, em torno da formação permanente. E aí surgiam também outros conceitos emanados e apresentados pelo grupo classe. Então, formação permanente, o currículo, formação permanente objetivando a construção de uma escola democrática com justiça social, a relação buscada entre a formação permanente e a leitura da realidade. Então, aqui, formação permanente requer leitura da realidade, exige diálogo, não se faz sem participação, e formação permanente orienta ensino-aprendizagem. Então, esses vários conceitos surgiram no momento de investigação temática. Daí eu passei a fazer uma segunda ação da metodologia de Freire, que é a chamada redução temática. Levei todos os registros, trouxe todos os registros para minha casa e organizei as falas, construí um quadro, retornei com esse quadro para os alunos para ver se eles se situavam, se reconheciam no quadro que eu organizei, e daí eu construí esta imagem que eu chamo de trama conceitual. Observem que na trama conceitual freiriana, diferentemente de outras possíveis organizações de articulação de conceitos, na trama conceitual freiriana estão necessariamente os conceitos que emanam da pedagogia de Freire, não estão outros conceitos aqui. E por que isso? Porque com esta estrutura, nós vamos construir o currículo do semestre do grupo da cátedra e que este grupo vai aprofundar estudos na direção da formação permanente e desses outros conceitos relacionados ao trabalho, relacionados à formação permanente. E que isto deve constituir elementos para que os alunos construam as suas pesquisas e aprofundem os conceitos. Bem, esta trama conceitual também tem sido muito utilizada como roteiro para a investigação de problemas que os alunos querem pesquisar. Ela não é padronizada, ela se constrói à medida em que o pesquisador lê a obra de Freire e compartilhar. Paula, por favor. E aí nós temos, eu quero dizer que desde o ano de 2001 eu tenho trabalhado na cátedra com a construção dessas tramas conceituais, tanto em contextos de ensino como de pesquisa. E o que faz com que seja possível construir as tramas é o caráter relacional do pensamento de Freire. Os conceitos implicam-se mutuamente em diversas direções possíveis. Embora plural, a construção da trama requer atenção ao fato de que as articulações respeitem a lógica interna da obra de Freire. A trama pode integrar diferentes conceitos, tendo em vista explicitar a leitura que o autor dessa construção faz da relação entre os temas conceitos. Para além de uma representação gráfica e de sua organização, as tramas têm conexão com uma dada realidade e buscam explicar ou inspirar ações de transformação dessa realidade. É aqui que se encontra o movimento de criar, recriar e decidir que permite a integração e não a acomodação ao seu contexto. A elaboração de tramas conceituais freirianas para o desenvolvimento de pesquisas ou contextos de ensino-aprendizagem requer do pesquisador a construção de representações que incluem conceitos que se unem uns aos outros, a partir de um conceito central. A relação entre o conceito central e os conceitos do entorno, ela pode ser unidirecional ou bidirecional. Entende-se, pois, que toda a trama é motivada por um objeto de estudo do seu autor, situado em um contexto cultural que inclui, além de fatos e dados da realidade, a percepção do pesquisador sobre essa mesma realidade. Por isso, as relações da trama podem variar, mesmo quando se propõe a compreensão ou explicitação de um mesmo conceito central. Eu tenho tido vários mestrandos e doutorandos que consideram importante construir tramas conceituais freirianas para explicitar a sua fundamentação teórica nos conceitos de Freire. Além da descrição, da análise da obra, eles terminam fazendo uma trama conceitual. E essa trama conceitual orienta o trabalho deles de busca de evidências da pesquisa e, ao mesmo tempo, se compõe em organizadores para a análise dos dados coletados. Isso tem sido muito apreciado, tanto pelos estudantes como por colegas que fazem parte das bancas examinadoras que analisam os trabalhos que são produzidos. Para finalizar, eu quero dizer que eu tenho muita saudade de Paulo Freire. Com ele aprendi política, teoria, prática docente e, mais do que tudo, lições de vida com um homem que buscava e demonstrava sempre uma praxis coerente, ousada e corajosa. Muito obrigada.
Muito obrigada, senhora professora Ana. Relatos incríveis, uma fala contundente, tudo que a gente precisa para começar, né, essa série de eventos que vamos ter nesses 12 dias. A potência, né, com que a senhora articula os seus conhecimentos com o conhecimento, o saber do Paulo Freire, nos motiva mais do que uma reflexão, né, mas nos impulsiona a reagir, como a senhora falou colocou na sua fala, em um reagir que transforme, né? E é isso que a gente está, né, nos dispondo aqui em Cambridge. Então, muito, muito obrigada. E agora eu vou mudar para o inglês, porque nós vamos fazer o welcome do professor Carlos Alberto Torres. So, and to keep learning and expanding this moment of singular reflection, we are honored to welcome Professor Carlos Alberto Torres. Professor Torres is a renowned thinker, prominent researcher, and refined theoretician. He has recently written the introduction to the new edition of Freire's book, Education for Critical Consciousness, originally written in English in 1973. In this piece, Professor Torres explores Freire's ontology, epistemology, and hermeneutics, and will share with us today some of his reflections on this. Dr. Torres often brings the power of Freire's dialogic thought and the power of the word. These words, steeped in sentiment, invite the ideas of others, enable dialogue, and strengthen the materialization of human thought. Like Professora Ana Saul, Dr. Carlos Alberto Torres has enjoyed a personal relationship with Paulo Freire, built up over 20 years of collaboration between the thinkers, including the period from 1989 to 1992, when Professor Carlos Alberto was Freire's advisor to his tenure as Secretary of Education of the city of São Paulo, Brazil. Carlos Alberto Torres is this distinguished professor of education and director of the Paulo Freire Institute at UCLA, former UNESCO UCLA chair in global learning and global citizenship education. Dr. Torres is a political sociologist of education, educated in Argentina, Mexico, United States, and Canada. He's also founding director of the Paulo Freire Institute in São Paulo, Brazil, Buenos Aires, Argentina, and UCLA. Dr. Torres is past president of the World Council of Comparative Education Societies, past president of the Research Committee of Sociology of Education from the International Sociological Association, and past president of the Comparative and International Education Society. He's a fellow of the Royal Society of Canada and corresponding member of the Mexican Academy of Sciences. He has published over 60 books and more than 300 peer-reviewed research articles and received 2 Fulbright grants. So, Professor Torres, the floor is all yours.
Thank you very much for this opportunity to be here. Thank you very much to Paula Teixeira de Castro. Muito obrigado por la introdução tão carinhosa e afetiva. I'd like to thank Professor Susan Robertson for the invitation, the team, very efficient team, as you can see. And I'd like to also argue that this celebration of the centenary of Paulo Freire is very much overdue, because Freire was himself a very important thinker in his lifetime, and now he's very much attacked in his own country. And I'm not so sure the idea that nobody is a prophet in their own land applies here. I think it's simply another way in which the politics of the identity have gone berserk. So let's start with the first slide, if I may, in which I like to speak about a hermeneutic analysis of Paulo Freire meta theory. And not by chance, I use the subtitle of Hegel's Phenomenology of the Spirit, Science of the Experience of Consciousness, which is exactly the way in which Freire understood how to understand education. Let's go to slide number one, please. Because the biography of Freire is well known, I will make only a few references to his biography. Yet, I would like to emphasize that he was an icon, a true living myth in his lifetime, I was with him in elevators that people will enter, recognize him, and get to the closest wall of the elevator, admiring this man who has given so much to education. There is no question that there is an iconography of Freire, perhaps a new romanticism, but also a new tribalism with a systematic attack to Freire by the current government of Brazil. There is no question that Freire is today the educator with the highest international reach in the world, in the same way that John Dewey was the best known philosopher of education in the 20th century, probably more in the first half than the second half. Freire was very prominent in the second half of the 20th century and continues to be very important in the first quarter of this century. As an example, Elliot Green compiled what are the most cited publications in the social sciences, a document of 2016, shows that Pedagogy of the Oppressed ranks third in the 25 most cited books in the social sciences, after Thomas Kuhn, The Structure of the Scientific Revolution, and believe me, of my generation, if you didn't read Thomas Kuhn, you will be expelled from the university. And of course, another book less known in some other parts of the world, but not less known in the US, Everett Rogers, Diffusion of Innovation. He was a professor at Stanford, where I studied. In fact, Pedagogy of the Oppressed is ranked as the most cited book in the field of education, following Thomas Kuhn's arguments, I will argue that Freire produced a rapid paradigm shift in educational sciences and beyond. Slide two, please. This reading paper, which I prepared for this occasion, but I also work not only on the question of the meta theory, but I work on the theory, on the methodology, on the question of pedagogy, and the question of the role of research for Freire, is not something that I can do today. So I will focus only in the meta theory, which I think is substantial to understand Freire. I don't think I will have the time, but if we have the time, there's a little concluding summary in which I will offer a brief commentary about the epistemology of the Global South, of which Freire is one of the originators, the hermeneutics of suspicion, which is part of the epistemology he developed, participatory action research, of which Freire himself, with a Colombian scholar, is really the creator of this model of research, ecopedagogy, which is the not written chapter of Pedagogy of the Oppressed, and of course, the potential contribution of Freire to global citizenship education and sustainability. Slide three, please. So let's talk about the meta-language and the meta-theory in Paulo Freire. What is meta-theory? In the broader sense, meta-theory is concerned with all of what which goes beyond, or precisely, is presupposed by theory as a substantive or concrete analysis of some aspect of social reality. A theory about theory, meta-theory takes up issues associated with the philosophy of social sciences, epistemology, ontology, ethics, and methodology, strategies of providing evidence for theoretical presuppositions. In short, from our perspective, meta-theory encompasses a set of assumptions about, first, the nature of things, the nature of the social world, the nature of science, also including the possibility of knowing them, and the normative assumptions required for assessing or evaluating different forms of reality, assuming that reality is always a social construction. Different forms of experience, that is, understanding the everyday life, and different forms of thought, the rational construction of reality, so much away from the mass media these days, and the experience and history of thought. Meta-theory thus takes as a necessary and legitimate activity the construction of a meta-language, a distinct from substantive theoretical discourses and or empirical analysis, whether explanatory or interpret it. I will present three different examples of exegesis of Freire meta theory. First, a very recent book just published 3 months ago in English on the philosophy of education by Walter Cohen, and offers a kind of socio-emotional and aesthetic-oriented philosophical biography of Freire. Second, from the perspective of the political sociology of education, I will present preliminary analysis I did a quarter of a century ago in my classes on politics and education at UCLA. In preparing this presentation, I went back to some of my old videos and I said, wow, I was working on this 25 years ago. And I decided to rescue some of that because very preliminary and maybe simplistic. Third, I will illustrate as a compatible and elaborated example the analysis that we have developed with Raymond Morrow on the foundational concept of Freire in the last 20 years. We have distinguished between the core and the diagnostic concept of Freire. So let's start with Walter Cohen's book, Paulo Freire, A Philosophical Biography, that has been published by Bloomsbury in England. It was first published in Spanish by Claxo in Buenos Aires. The concept that articulates the analysis of polysticity, and there is a problem here of a neologism. I like to call it politicity, because that was the way in which I hear Pablo say it in 1983 when I was doing my PhD at Stanford, and I invited him to give us a 1 month course. And when he used the word politicity, everybody in the room knew what he meant. And he said, but I'm not so sure it's an English, thank you very much, it's an English word. And everybody almost at unison said, now it is. So I will use that. The translation in Cohen's book is politicality. It doesn't have the same sense to me. Now, he says, and I quote, the five principles could be summed up in five words: life, equality, love, errantry, and childhood or infancy. Thank you for this glass of water. So, Cohen concludes saying, I affirm that politicity of education inspired by Freire trusts the presence and power of those five words. Let me elaborate from my perspective. I agree with those five words. Why they are important. Life. If one looks at the most relevant representative of philosophy of education in Latin America, Enrique Dussel, we'll discover in his last book about the question of ethics in the context of different elements connected with neoliberalism, he argued that life is the principle of any global planetary ethics. And in a way, it's right, because everything we do is about our own life. And if you look at the Declaration of Independence in the US, this very and often cited description of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness defines what the founding fathers, were all males, of the American Constitution considered central in the arguments. So what I will say Dussel is suggesting is that there are two principles on this model of ethics, global ethics, that he suggested. The first one is rejecting any Eurocentric perspective. In this context, Dussel is positioned squarely in the decolonial pedagogy, which Freire also is considered one of the founders. Secondly, there is not a universalist but a planetarian ethic. I'm not so sure Enrique did solve the problem of universality versus specificity, or universality versus discrete news, discrete. But that is his argument at the moment in a very, very large book that condensed most of his learning in all the 7, 8 languages that he speaks over the last 60 years. So let me go now to my early exegesis. In my classes, I developed these three meta-theoretical principles from Freire. First, the world of work connected with the world vision, the Weltanschauung of the socially subordinated sectors with whom he worked in Brazil, in Chile, in Europe, even in Africa, and back into Brazil when he said, I'm coming back to learn the Gramsci in the favelas. What he was doing is working around these needs of individuals in promoting political literacy and citizenship building. In this interpreted context, there are hints of his interest in the theme of alienation, which for different reasons, he could not fully address in his work. A vignette in one sentence. When I was with him many years ago in Campinas, I asked him, Paulo, what can you tell me about alienation in the popular sectors? Because I'm very convinced that even in the popular sectors, males really affect women and so on and so forth. Pablo looked at me and said, I have not thought about that. In fact, I understood his answer very well. It was so much his respect for the socially subordinated sectors, he did not want to express anything that could be used against them somehow. But it's true that alienation was also, jointly with recognition, central concerns for Hegel in Phenomenology of the Spirit, which I'm absolutely convinced Paulo read from beginning to end. Assessing the importance of praxis, Freire's pedagogical model uses constant references, particularly in his early work and throughout his oeuvre, to class struggle as the archetype of the struggle against structures of oppression. On the side, many of you may have thought, why Freire uses oppression? Why not exploitation? We don't have the time to go into this discussion, but I give you a hint. It's a very strong religious term. And oppression then seemed to encompass every single model of domination and exploitation. And of course, Freire, at the beginning of his academic career, was a very devoted Catholic. So, in my sense, is that the Weltanschauung that Freire is knowing about the subordinate sectors, seeking that the knowledge and wisdom of this population be honored and respected in the pedagogical work is another fundamental principle. I quote him, we cannot, unless we are foolish, expect positive results of educative labor that does not respect the people's particular vision of the world and whose program includes a kind of cultural invasion, which is, by the way, a good example of alienation. Cultural invasion, although done with the best of intentions, nonetheless, it remains a cultural invasion. There is a very interesting sentence in the traditional medieval Spanish culture. The path to hell is paved with good intentions. And Freire continues, that was me, by the way, not Freire. Only by beginning with an actual, concrete, existential situation that reflects the people's choice of aspirations will we be able to work on the programmatic contents of education. What we must do is to outline for the people their concrete existential situation. So consider the question of universality as a problem that challenges them per se and therefore demands their response. This response in turn has to be given not only on an intellectual level, but in terms of action. It's my own translation of a part of work of Freire that I put in Leitura Critica de Paulo Freire, one of my first books. Unfortunately, this meta principle of his work did not lead Freire towards an analysis of the political economy of capitalism and its analytical constellations. Yet, in the last stage of his life, having fully embraced a model of dialogical, deliberative, and participative radical democracy, confronted the impacts of globalization and was especially critical of neoliberalism. Let me offer you another vignette. I was traveling in 1997 from Los Angeles to Madrid, driving my car to the airport. And I felt an immense need to call Paulo Freire at home. Don't ask me why, I don't know. So I called from my car and he answered the phone and we talk about things, usually how with the family, etc. But my call then allowed me to ask him if he had thought about the topics that he and I will do over that fall in Cambridge, Massachusetts, to do a new book on reinserting Paulo Freire in the 21st century. And he said to me, in a way that was not only direct, but seemed almost laconic, "Carlos, we have to criticize neoliberalism. It's the new demon of the world today." And at that moment, reaching the airport, the communication affected my connection. The phone was dead. And 3 days later, Paulo Freire was dead. So that was my last learning from the great master. A second early meta principle of his work focuses on the theme of communication, which is very appropriate in this book, Education for Critical Consciousness, which, by the way, is a book understood because that is where the majority of the epistemology of Freire is presented. And was one of the first books presented in English from Freire. The title of this book is The Archetype of the Freirean Analysis in All His Phases and Diverse Forms of Organization. My original analysis identified a few different moments in Freire's meta-theoretical work. First, an analytical moment in the construction of critical literacy as a form of social, individual, and collective emancipation. Mind you, that in the terminology of Freire, liberation and emancipation are parallels. They are different in law, they are different in philosophy, but not in the concept of Freire. So from the moment that he considers emancipation emerged the concept of conscientization that he adapted from other environments and connect with the concept of liberation, liberation that was very much in vogue at the time of the region. You have theology of liberation, you have philosophy of liberation, of which Freire is considered one of the pioneers. There is a synthetic moment that is propelled by his appointment as director of the National Commission of Popular Culture in Brazil in 1963. In this moment, his model of critical literacy for adults, which was part of a larger goal of socialization of a new system of education. Freire had designed the Freirean system while working as director of extension in the Faculty of Extension of the University of Recife. So, in this context, he actually created a model of political education in the construction of democratic citizenship. This model of political education is at the same time a model of democratic inclusion, considering that a massive literacy campaign that Freire was in charge of proposed for the first time in Brazil, a model of inclusion for the democratic vote in the nascent Brazilian democracy. Until then, Brazilians who could not read and write your own name could not vote. Without inclusion, access to voting, there is no democracy, nor citizenship building in any democracy, because citizenship is linked to the socialization of the social subjects. I will go back to this concept later on in the argument that we make with Raymond. But I want to remind you that in many educational paradigms, we understood the pedagogical subjects. And therefore, it's imperative this socialization at all levels, because education has a fundamental role of inclusion, but also of understanding diversity and difference. One could argue that his original work was a multicultural undertaking. The third meta-theoretical principle that Freire embraced throughout his life and work is the defense of democracy as a precondition for social transformation and as a fundamental element for humanization. Freire makes an explicit link between humanization and democratization. He defined this explicit link as an ontological and historical foundation in the political struggle for democracy and its permanent improvement. It is possible to argue that there is a summative moment for Freire when he links his perspective of citizenship with the concept of popular culture, even if there is a culture of silence that may undermine the voices of the popular culture. And also the parallel concept so relevant at the beginning of the work of Freire of popular education is still a central concept in some regions of the world, Latin America in particular. And we have argued in the work with Raymond Morrow, this first phase of Freire was guided by a model of society confronting masses and elites, elaborated from a liberal democratic perspective. The goal was fundamental democratization, with an emphasis in the contribution of education to the nationalistic and developmentalist project of modernization in Brazil. And yet, out of this preoccupation, a new tradition emerged from different directions and with different impact when it's formulated as a theory of dependency. 3 decades later, when we were in the Secretary of Education, Municipality of Sao Paulo, Freire endorsed the concept of escola cidadã, or citizenship school. Another possible concept could be educação pública popular. As I term in my book published in Portuguese, Pedagogy of Struggle from the Pedagogy of the Oppressed to Public Popular Schooling. Freire defined his concept of an education for citizenship in an interview with the Educational TV of Rio de Janeiro that took place in the archives. Paulo Freire, Jusso Gadotti, my dear friend and brother, is speaking from these archives. And the meeting was on March 19, 1997 in the Paulo Freire Institute of Sao Paulo. The interview took place less than 3 months of his passing. He spoke of a concession of escola cidade, or citizenship school, in a very Hegelian narrative, is my translation, so you can blame me if you don't consider that he was a Hegelian. He cites, and I quote, "The citizen school is the one that assumes itself at the center of rights and obligations. What characterizes this school is citizenship education. The citizen school then is the school that helps those citizens who are part of the school and those who come into the school. This citizen school cannot be in and for itself. The citizen school cannot be in and for itself. This school is a citizen school as long as it practices and constructs citizenship by those persons that use this space. The citizen school is a coherent model with freedom. It is coherent with its formative discourse and its discourse for liberation. The citizen school is every school that, while struggling to be itself, struggles for the students' educators also to be by themselves. And because nobody can be by itself alone, the citizen school is a communitarian school, a companionship school. The citizen school is a school for knowledge and freedom of common production. It is a school that leaves the tense experience of democracy, as we all live in Europe, in the US particularly. Let me conclude this part with a note about Freire metalanguage. In the middle of the 1980s, writing for a North American audience, Henry Giroux popularized the concept of critical theory, then he called it critical pedagogy, as the language of possibility, identifying the central categories of Freire as follows, and I quote Giroux. What Freire does provide is a metalanguage that generates a set of categories and social practices that have to be critically mediated by those who use them for the insights they might provide in different historical settings and contexts. This is a text of 1985. Let me go to the third example, the recent analysis we have done with Morrow for the last 2 decades. We make a distinction between foundational concepts or core concepts or generative concepts of the pedagogical paradigm of Freire and diagnostic concepts. Hence, the social, theoretical, and methodological assumptions that guide contextualization. And I underscore the word contextualization, which for Freire has always been central. Let me start. I will propose 5. First, oppression as a foundational, generative, or core concept. Let me bring to you Freire again from the book I quote before that I published in Spanish and quotations. Whereas the violence of the oppressors prevent the oppressed from being fully human, the response of the latter to this violence is grounded in the desire to pursue the right to be human. As the oppressors dehumanize others and violate their rights, they themselves also become dehumanized. As the oppressed, fighting to be human, take away the oppressor's power to dominate and suppress. They restore to the oppressors the humanity they had lost in the exercise of oppression. It is only the oppressed who, by freeing themselves, can free their oppressors. The latter, as an oppressive class, can free neither others nor themselves. If this is not a Hegelian statement from phenomenology of the spirit, I don't know what it is. This concept sensitizes us on how it operates at various levels, ontological, hence anthropologically, as a form of dehumanization distinctive of the human species, ethical, as a violation of human dignity, freedom, and autonomy, and historical empirical, its appearance in different social formation and different configurations of domination. Second concept, humanization and liberation are another pair of core generative concepts that really invites an anthropological reconstruction. I think I was the first one that argued that Freire was doing a political anthropological reconstruction and using that reconstruction to alter the pedagogical concepts. That evolutionary and social history has a contingent potential for directionality as cumulative evidence, despite regressions in processes of dehumanization, humanization. Awareness of such humanization possibilities gives rise to moral obligations that constitute a distinctive human vocation. That is Freire at his very best. Although that's one sentence, not a sentence of him, it's a sentence withdrawn from him. That humanization is contracted in part through a struggle of oppression, liberation, whose intersubjective logic can be understood metaphorically in terms of Hegel's allegory of recognition of the master and slave dialectic and the principle that no one can be free until all are free. Humanization is also an ontological vocation, which is described as follows, and I quote Freire. It is because this is the way we are that we live the life of a vocation, a calling to humanization, And that in dehumanization, which is a concrete fact in history, we live the life of a distortion of the call. Never another calling. Neither one. Humanization or dehumanization is sure destiny. Given datum or fate, this is precisely why the one is calling and the other distortion of the calling. And you can see the almost theological underpinnings of the sentence written in 1984. So the allegory of Hegel's master-slave dialectic as a struggle for recognition informs the ontology of oppression liberation. Let me go to the third element. The critical theory of the dialogical and developmental subject, which is the third core generative word. We are programmed to learn is a very strong principle that Freire adjudicated to his work throughout his life. That the necessary condition of possibility of humanization and struggles for mutual recognition is a dialogical and development subject whose self-understanding is constituted through mutual recognition and a dialectic of being and becoming that can flourish only under condition of relative non-oppression that release the potential of biophilia and reduce its pathological distortions and necrophilia in relation to both society and nature. Here you can see the influence of critical theory a la Frankfurt, particularly Erich Fromm. Freire is working with a shared critical theory of the dialogical and developmental subject. Why? Because he rejects a monological and transcendental theory of the subject, that is, a subject which is based in an abstract metaphysical I that individualistically knows the world. Instead, Freire locates selfhood and identity formation in context of intersubjective communication. Their strategy is developmental because it argues that identity formation has, despite variable cultural context, directional potential for growth that can be fully realized only under optimal conditions of socialization. Number three, dialogue is a generative concept in Freire and a substantial coda for a radical democracy. Dialogical relationship is a fundamental practice to human nature and to democracy, on the other hand, on the other hand, as an epistemological requirement for democracy. Dialogism must not be understood as a tool used by the educator at times in keeping with his or her political choices. Dialogism, Freire says, is a requirement of human nature and also a sign of the educator democratic stand. So we can go with the same argument. Ontologically, dialogism is a requirement of human nature. Ethically, embracing dialogism is an ontological vocation. Historical empirical is a strategic pedagogical practice in which the teachers show their commitment to democracy. So let me finish number five, politicity of education. If there is one concept that requires more than one dissertation in Paulo Freire, is the concept of politicity of education. I've been studying this since I read Freire for the first time in 1974. And in the end, I discovered that the answer is in a term that was first coined by Roger Dale when he spoke about the political sociology of education, which I endorse because while he was working on this, I was working in Stanford on looking at theories of the state to identify the foundations of a political sociology of education. So Roger and I, on parallel ways, were looking at a sub-discipline of the sociology of education. Now, I wrote this article that has been collected in several different books and et cetera, even in England not long ago. is called The State and Education Revisited, or Why Educational Researchers Should Think Politically About Education. I don't have the time to go into the great detail of this article, but I will say the following. Theories of the state, the nature of the state, and the nature of public policy are substantive importance for an understanding of the political nature of education, a public policy formation. What Freud defined as the politicis of education should be in terms of defining the real problems of education and the most appropriate, cost-effective, ethically acceptable, and legitimate solutions, which depend greatly on the theories of the state that underpin, justify, and guide the educational diagnosis and propose solutions. Mind you, that those theories of the state from which the great organizers of our educational system speak from are never declared upfront. They can be understood very easily, but it's not something that they put upfront. I continue. In order to understand the politicity of education, we shall review classical theories of the relationship between the polity and education, liberal, neoconservative, neoliberal reformulation of these theories, and neo-Marxist, post-structuralist, and postmodern critiques of these formulations. Without a clear understanding of all these theories, we will never understand the politicity of education. The analysis should be further enriched by examining the contribution of feminist theories and by exploring how all the above theories relate to such issues as multiculturalism. Any analysis of the relationship between education and the state should take into account the multi-layered, complex, and dynamic nature of these relationships, revealing the multitude of tensions and contradictions that emerge out of the historical and social force buffeting political and educational institutions. Finally, any contemporary discussion of the relationship between the state and education shall be placed in the context of the globalization of economies, cultures, and societies. I think I have spoken for about 30 minutes. I could stop here and then engage everybody in conversation. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Professor Torres. As we say in Portuguese, Brazilian, it's a feijoada that we have to digest. It was an extraordinary opportunity you have given us by sharing this profound knowledge and refined insights with us. We thank you once again for your kindness and availability. Now, I'll give the floor to Professor Susan Robertson, the head of faculty of education at Cambridge University, who will lead the conversation with our distinguished guests. Please, Professor Susan.
So thank you so much for those two wonderful interventions. In the interest of time, I'm just going to really go straight to a provocation, I think, that Carlos put there. And then I'm going to pass it across to each of our interlocutors, Ana Maria and Carlos. Essentially, Carlos, in the last conversation that you had with Paulo Freire, the whole question of how you put his work into the 21st century. So I'm perhaps going to pass this over. This is the final question from Carlos. But I'm wondering, Ana Maria, what are your thoughts about how that insertion, how and why, and with what importance that insertion of Paulo Freire's work into the 21st century, from your perspective, what might your thoughts be?
Sim, devo dizer, fazer algumas considerações a respeito. Obrigada, Susan. Quero dizer que, sem dúvida, a obra de Paulo Freire é cada vez mais atual neste século, porque estamos, sim, e temos remarcado isto, muitos analistas tem remarcado, o próprio Carlos mostrou isso, nós estamos em diversas partes do mundo vivendo ameaças fortes à democracia. Especialmente no Brasil, nós temos uma democracia fraturada. E estamos vivendo, sim, sob opressão constante. Então, isto quer dizer que nós precisamos cada vez mais dos ensinamentos de Freire, precisamos cada vez mais nos aprofundar na obra de Freire para entendê-lo e para fazer emergir daí uma ação de resistência, uma ação coletiva, uma ação que nos auxilie coletivamente para nos contrapormos a esta situação, que desumaniza, não só estudantes, educadores, mas as populações em geral e principalmente as populações mais vulneráveis. Enquanto tivermos populações vulneráveis e sob opressão, precisamos cada vez mais de Freire.
Thank you so much, Ana Maria. And for sure, backsliding on democracy all over the world, actually, rising social inequalities. Carlos, your thoughts, your final thoughts on the question I asked, inserting Paulo Freire into the 21st century?
Thank you, Susan. I think Paulo Freire is already inserted in the 21st century. The question is, to what extent democracy will survive to be able to implement Paulo Freire? And if that is a question that worries me, worries many other people, because we are facing now an onslaught of right-wing, there are different ways to terminology, but I would say a right-wing populist positions moving from that end to the other end, which will be a neo-Nazism. And the peculiarity of this process is that it has reached levels that they were not expected before. And they are reaching this level because democracy opens up the possibility for freedom to be acted out in ways that eliminates freedom. And that will be an element that Freire will never accept. But to put it in pedagogical terms, I think if we can implement some of the critical arguments of Freire, the methodology in terms of looking at what the communities are experimenting, the dreams and the wishes, and in that process of experimenting, they understand the limitations and the possibilities, then a generative world will come, and this generative world will be the basis of a curriculum instruction. That's one element that Freire articulated so many years ago, and it was attempted during the administration of Freire, and Ana Maria Seul was a very crucial component of this administration. She was the eminence grie of the pedagogical part, because Freire, of course, was presiding over, but to administer a particular 600,000 students, project, teachers, et cetera, is not really what the Minister of Education does, really is what the people in the ministry do. So my sense is that if you found that methodology useful, then you will find the other techniques, the codification, decodification, et cetera, very useful. And finally, look at the description I did today. Just pick one, dialogue. If we can create a model of dialogue in our classrooms, as much of our in the streets, as much or in the connection between children and parents, lovers among themselves, the connection between the administration of a particular city and the people in the city. If we can create this notion of dialogue that works effectively in putting forward initiatives that come from the bottom and not from the top, while sometimes coming from the top are very good if the top is well organized around principles of political philosophy that really connects with the bottom principle. If we can have all of that happening at the same time, then Freire will be just one of the many resources, because Freire is not an all. There are many very important in the history of pedagogy contributors, and Freire himself read them. So my point being, Freire will continue to be alive and well because he's already been penetrating many of the sources of our thinking. And if you see the other element is that now you have not people like me, the 60s and 70s people like us, but essentially people who were born much less after he was dead that are embracing his language of possibility, to use the argument of Giroud. So my sense is that Freire is still here, is very much in our opportunity. Just by looking, I have been invited to give tons of lectures, and everybody who has worked with Freire is the same. There are lectures, there are meetings, there are conferences. Freire is pretty much alive and well in the 100th anniversary of his life and work. So my sense is that what we are doing here is not only celebrating, because we have to celebrate the success, but also remembering, and the question of memory continues to be central in the construction of democracy.
Thank you so much, Carlos. And I think the challenge, I think, is to not simply have a symbol, but to actually advance a program and a project. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. So we have come now to the end of this opening event. And on behalf of CLARIC, I really want to thank you all for being here, both in person and online. We've already thanked to all our partners, institutions, who are many, but I would like to repeat that. Thank you, Professor Carlos Alberto, Ana Maria, and Professor Susan, for your words. I found them very insightful. And I believe that your presentations are a great example of how relevant Paulo Freire's ideas remained, but also of how crucial, and I think that you kind of mentioned that towards the end, how crucial it is for us to reinvent them collectively in light of the current challenges that we're facing. And we truly, truly hope that these two following weeks will be an opportunity for us to do that, to connect between each other's work, to encounter. And I think I was looking at the chat, and I think that the conversations and all the exchange that happened there goes very much in the spirit of what we really want to achieve for these 2 weeks. We have many events happening. Of course, you can look into the program for further details. But I would like to mention two main activities. One is tomorrow's seminar organized by the Real Center on Paulo Freire and climate change education. And also next Monday here in the same auditorium, the student conference will take place. And we have talked a lot about how important students and teacher-student relationship are in Freire's ideas. So I think I will invite you, all of you, to come or to connect online as well, to hear about 21 presentations of students all over the world who are working and reworking Paulo Freire's ideas today. Now I welcome, well, for all of you who are in person here, welcome you all to share some refreshments. I believe those are at the Faculty of Education, the next building, and hopefully to keep the conversation going. Thank you, everyone.